394 season will please come to order. Welcome, everybody. We're glad to see so many here tonight. It couldn't be the budget that would bring you out, so it must be something else. The roll call by the town clerk, please.
Chairman Chappell?
Here.
Counsel Cogswell?
Here.
Counsel Dahlbeck?
Here.
Counsel Jordan?
Yeah.
Counsel Lanelle?
Here.
Counsel Marvin?
Here.
And Counsel McGlaughlin?
Here.
Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. You have before you the minutes of the meeting number 16, held April the 11th, 1994. What's your pleasure?
I'll move they be accepted as printed.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. Citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. These are something that we haven't got here that you'd like to talk about. Why, this is the time that you come up and give your name and address and go ahead and talk. I'm not going to wait too long. Seeing none, we'll move right along. Tonight, we're very lucky. It's probably one of the best times that a council has is when we can give a few presentations out. And it always is good to do it when we have other things on the agenda because it brings people out, too. So we have a group here to see these presentations. After the presentations, if you will, we've got to continue working. But you haven't. You can socialize a little bit. And downstairs in the cafeteria, you'll find something hot and something dainty to eat. And so if you'll move out of here and down there and socialize, it'll be wonderful. We're trying this. If you don't use it, it'll never happen again, so you better do it.
They don't use it, we get it.
They don't use it. So if you will, bear with me. I've got a few presentations tonight, and then we'll get into the main part of the meeting. I don't know how many of the chairmen left Little League and all the rest to get here, but I hope we have a few. I'm going to read them off and ask them to come down. I know I've got one, I've got two. Well, I got two out of six. That's pretty good. And they'll get their plaque, and the others we'll keep right here and give it to them at some later date. What I thought might be interesting to all of you people that have come out and also the people at home, I asked the manager this afternoon if he would get together an estimate of the number of meetings that all of the boards and commissions at the Cape have had this past year and how many man-hours and women-hours those would be. And he did that for us and took the minutes and how many persons were there and all this and all that. 12,307 hours were volunteered at the Cape this past year. Just think of it. 12,307. It makes a chairman of the council happy. It makes the council happy. The only reason that the town runs as well as it does is not because of this council sitting up here, although we take a lot of credit for it. It's those boards and commissions. They are just wonderful. Think of going on the planning board or the zoning board or the family fund day, and if I don't name them all, I'll be in trouble, but I'm not going to. And sitting up here sometimes one or two nights a week till 10, 10:30, 11 o'clock, all volunteer. I just think it's wonderful. So if I can have, you're right here on the end, Bill. You help me with these six here. And we'll see how many of these we've got here tonight. Pat Carroll, are you here? Well, I don't have to worry about that one. Larry Clough, you are. Come on down here. Larry has been just giving up his, giving it up is the right way to put it, isn't it? You really wanted to stay on, yeah. Peel's chairman of the zoning board, and nice little plaque for him. And I'm going to ask him to stay down here till I see how many more I've got. Larry, don't go away. Russell Erickson? Boy, I'm doing good tonight. Steve Etzel? Steve's finishing up his year as the planning board Chairman, and my pleasure to give you this deed. Don't go away. Kenneth Gray? Carolyn Smith?
She's just coming through the door.
Carolyn, come on down here. Carolyn, my pleasure to give you this plaque for your work as the Advisory Commission Chairman of Fort Williams.
Thank you very much.
Congratulations. Stand over here. Let's give him a great big hand. I just finished telling the group here that we've got refreshments downstairs, so I will be very hurt if any of you three leave the hall at the present time. Thank you. No, don't go away. Oh, you can go. Yeah, I'm all set. This one gives me a great deal of pleasure, really. The presentation of the Ralph T. Gould Award for Outstanding Citizenship. Tonight, my honor to present the Ralph T. Gould Award for 1994. The award, established in 1986, was named for the late Ralph Gould to recognize his community service and subsequently to recognize those who provide community service in the same spirit as Ralph Gould. Recipients since Mr. Gould have been Bill Orcott, who has done much for the youth of the town, Judith Simons, a strong advocate for the arts and school board member, Dick O'Donnell for his efforts on behalf of the elderly, Henry Adams for numerous works on behalf of the town, Loretta Pond for her service on school issues, and I was pleased to receive the award as well prior to my service as a member of the town council. Now, for the first time in 1994, I'm going to announce the name or names, and they will please come up, and then I'll read the rest of this, if I may. I'll have a little break in there for you to kind of do a little cheering and hollering if you'd like to. For the first time in 1994, the town council is pleased to present the award to co-honorees. They are Alice Hildreth Rand and Peter Whitcomb Rand. Would you two please come on up? I'm going to read the rest of this before I give the plaques to the two co-honorees. It's nice to have it happen this way. One I know didn't know anything about it, and I'm not sure of the other one, but it worked very well. Both have been in the forefront on environmental issues to protect the town and the state's natural resources. Alice and Peter Rand moved to Cape Elizabeth in January of 1957. Almost constantly since that time, they have been involved in activities assisting the community and the state. Alice served through much of the turbulent 1980s on the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board, including serving as its chairman. During her tenure as chairman, the board prepared an entirely new subdivision ordinance, worked cooperatively with South Portland to review common planning issues, and reviewed projects as diverse as the Inn by the Sea and Cape Woods. She helped the town develop a visual resources assessment and is currently working on a Maine Department of Transportation committee where she is advocating for funds to improve a section of the Cape Elizabeth Greenbelt. Alice was appointed to the initial Land for Maine's Future Board by Governor John McKiernan. She has served as president of the Maine Audubon Society and is a member of the board of the Portland Museum of Art. She assisted the town council in its ordinance committee with the preparation of numerous ordinance amendments. Peter Rand was a founding chairman of the Cape Elizabeth Conservation Commission. He served as chairman for 18 years, leading the effort to develop two greenbelt plans, a water quality testing program, the creation of resource protection districts, and the preservation of areas with sensitive soils. Through negotiation, he obtained numerous conservation easements. He represented the commission on the Comprehensive Planning Commission and at countless meetings on sewering issues. Peter was a founder of the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust and served as this independent group's chairman. He was on the board of the Maine Coast Heritage Trust and has served as state advisory committee relating to health issues. He has assisted the town on numerous occasions with information on deer ticks, Lyme disease, and radon. Peter and Alice also had such space in their home taken up by a voluminous collection of town maps. Peter and Alice Rand have jointly given over 6,000 hours of volunteer time in service to protect our community and our state's natural resources. This is the equivalent of a full-time job for 1,000 days. On behalf of the Town Council and the citizens of Cape Elizabeth, it is an extreme privilege to present the 1994 Ralph T. Gould Award to Alice H. and Peter W. Rand. Presented to Alice H. Rand and Peter W. Rand, M.D., for outstanding citizenship. Hold that, will you? Isn't that nice? And then along with that, their names are here on the permanent display that's here at the Town Hall. The first one with Alice H. and Peter W. Rand, 1994. You can clap now. Now, which one would you like to say a few words? You've got them. It's all yours.
Well, I can't speak. I'm just dumbfounded by this. It came as a complete surprise. Alice and I are both extraordinarily proud of this, and it could not have come from a better source than Ralph T. Gould. And we thank you all very, very much.
Now, don't all leave. We're getting into the budget.
He was hungry.
Don't forget, I'll repeat once more. Everybody's welcome downstairs. Spend a few words with Peter and Alice, and have a good time, and we'll see you later. Now we get to reports and correspondence. Any reports or correspondence tonight? Janet McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. That's a very hard act to follow. Hope those folks enjoy themselves. Greater Portland Council of Governments, the Executive Committee is currently working on its bylaws, and I want the Council to take note that the annual meeting of GPCOG is tentatively scheduled for Wednesday, June 8th. Will be only a business meeting. We are planning a 25th anniversary meeting for the fall for GPCOG. Last Monday night, the Appointments Committee of Councillor Linnell, Councillor Marvin, and myself, and the Chairman, met with the Chairman of our boards and commissions and had a very worthwhile discussion and informative evening with those folks. And the third thing I'd like to report on is that the Council Chairman has appointed the members of the Zoning Ordinance Rewrite Committee, which you'll be hearing about as the ZORC group. Chair of that committee will be Councillor Phyllis Cogsell. The other members will be Steve Etzel, Bob Perna, Keith Moe, and Janet McKay. And we certainly wish them well in their endeavors in the next year and a half or so. Thank you.
Thank you. Any others? We'll move right along to public hearing on the general fund budget and special fund. Oh, I'm sorry.
I had something else.
Well, that's all right. You can come back in for a minute.
Some people have been asking, what is that orange thing? This was one of the most delightful pieces of mail I've received as a counselor. When Councillor Cogsell and I were in Washington in March for National League of Cities conference, I sat at one of the luncheons with an older gentleman who was a counselor from Kirkwood, Missouri, and saw him again at one of the later sessions. We got to chatting with him, and he mentioned that he was a volunteer in a second grade classroom in his community. So the light went on, and we said, oh, wouldn't it be great if you could set up a pen pal relationship with a second grade in Cape Elizabeth. Well, last Monday, I guess it was, it came into town hall to my mailbox, and I had 15 letters from second graders in Kirkwood, Missouri. Now, these are just delightful. They want to know about our Indians. They want to know if we all live in lighthouses. They want to know if we have pizza in Maine. And they want to know if we have grassy fields, and if we have floods, and if we have found any dinosaur bones, things like that. I've started doing some responses, and we're in the process of working out a pen pal relationship with a class over at Pond Cove. That's another one of the hidden benefits we get when we go to conferences like National League of Cities. Thank you.
Thank you. We all set on reports and correspondence now?
Yeah.
Okay. Moving right along to, we have a public hearing on general fund budget and special fund budgets. Is there anybody from the public sitting out there that would like to talk about the budget? You better rush right up there to the microphone if you do, because I'm going to call the budget hearings closed. Thank you very much. Item number 158, to consider public hearing comments. That's going to be kind of hard to do, isn't it? Public hearing
comments. Shouldn't take long.
On the proposed fiscal year 1995 general fund budget and take any necessary action. This part, item number 158 through 164, I will turn over to our Finance Committee Chairman, Councilor Jordan.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just want to present to the town a general fund budget, and also there's some other sewer fund budgets in Riverside, Spurring Church, Fallen Headlight, Fort Williams Park, and the Fort Williams Park Capital Projects. The budget was reviewed by the council, which is made up of the Finance Committee as a whole council, and we went through the budget thoroughly, and we have able to keep the budget as no increase. The only increase that you'll find as far as the taxes go is through the new school building project. And it looks as though the rate will stay the same as last year at 1770, but with the revaluation, I think most everybody's going to find an increase in their tax bill, which is mostly due to, as far as the construction of the schools, the general budgets and whatever, as far as the school wants to be commended to keeping a no increase, even though they didn't get their fully funded back from the state as they anticipated. It was down a little bit. They'll get into that a little bit when they get to the school budget. So I don't have any other that I want to add to it. If there's anybody that, member of the council, that has a question or something, I'll start off with 158. Ordered that the Capitalist Town Council, having held a public hearing on May 9, 1994, does hereby adopt the municipal budget for the fiscal year 1995 with a gross expenditure of $15,946,845 and a gross revenue of $4,686,701 in the amount. The amount of $11,260,144 to be raised by taxation, and does further fix Tuesday, October 4, 1994, and Tuesday, April 4, 1995, as the dates upon each of which one half of your of such tax is due and payable, with interest to accrue upon the tax due and unpaid after each such date at the rate of 10% per annum. And I so move.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Discussion? Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just want to make note for everybody to be aware that we are again having taxes due in April. This was the first year we had done that. There was some concern expressed about that. We are doing that in order to save the town money, basically. It prevents us from having to go out for a tax anticipatory note, and it does save the town money. We are aware of people's concerns about that, but I, for one, will be voting in favor of this. I think it makes sense in the big picture for the town.
Any other discussion? Entertain a motion. I have it.
I have one.
All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. Councilor Jordan?
To consider a public hearing comments on proposed fiscal year 1995 sewer fund budget and taken necessary action. The sewer fund budget hasn't had an increase of a very little in the last few years, and we have a committee looking at the sewer projects within the town and to see if we can help in the future, which will increases will come along, will help the sewer fund budget. So I so move number 159 is be it ordered. The Cable Town Council, having held a public hearing on May 9th, 1994, does hereby adopt the fiscal year 1995 sewer fund budget with a gross expenditure of $1,480,794 and gross revenues of $1,433,890. I move the adoption.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Discussion? All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. Councilor Jordan?
The next item is 160, is consider the Riverside Cemetery budget, and I haven't anything to add. That is pretty much takes care of itself, and the revenue from it takes care as far as the maintenance and what have you of the Riverside Cemetery. So ordered that the Cable Town Council, having held a public hearing on May 9th, 1994, does hereby adopt the fiscal year 1995 Riverside Cemetery Fund budget with gross expenditures of $9,345 and gross revenues of $25,660. So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. Councilor Jordan?
Next on the agenda is the Spurling Church budget, and the Spurling Church with the revenues from weddings and whatever. I did have a note here, but I don't have it right in front of me now. Revenues of weddings and within the church managed to take care pretty much of the budget for the year, and with a little left over. And there is some maintenance going on as far as new carpets being placed within the church, and we're constantly doing little projects as far as the church to maintain it, to keep it in sound condition. So I'll order that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, having held a public hearing on May 9th, 1994, does hereby adopt fiscal year 1995 Spurling Church fund budget with a gross expenditure of $4,466 and gross revenue of $5,400. I so move.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. Councilor Jordan?
Beginning to sound like a broken record. The next is a Portland Headlight budget. And I don't know of anything that I can really add to it. The gift shop and what have you does a tremendous job to carry on as far as the Portland Headlight. And they do have a lot of visitors there. I don't know if anybody needed any more details as far as that goes. I believe someone could answer the questions, but I do hope everyone that lives in the Cape do spend some time at the fort. So I will order that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, having held a public hearing on May 9th, 1994, does hereby adopt the fiscal year 1995 museum at Portland Headlight budget with a gross expenditure of $217,408 and gross revenues of $254,700. I so move.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. Councilor Jordan, please.
The next one is the Fort William Capital Fund budget. The capital fund budget is a change, in my opinion, in the process of capital projects within the Fort Williams. It has it so that the Fort Williams committee will be raising, having fundraisers or raising money to do capital projects within the Fort Williams. And in the years past, we have appropriated so much money as far as capital projects within the past, but this is a new way of doing projects within the fort. I, for one, kind of disagreed with the change because I always felt that if there was a capital project need to be done, that it should be come into the and be budgeted within the town budget. But as the budget process went through, that it was agreed with the majority of them that it should be done this way. Be it ordered that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council does hereby establish a Fort Williams Parks capital budget. It is the intent of the Town Council to have all revenue generated within Fort Williams Park to be placed in the Fort Williams capital budget beginning in the fiscal year 1996. It is the intent that all capital improvements within Fort Williams Park with a cost of over $5,000 shall be funded from the Fort Williams capital account. On any specific project, the Town Council shall receive a recommendation from Fort Williams Advisory Committee with the Town Council to provide final review and action. I so move.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Discussion. Councilor Coggeshall.
I would propose an amendment to that motion that would read that all revenues generated within Fort Williams, excluding those by the Portland Headlight, would be put in this account.
Portland Headlight Museum.
Other discussion?
Museum.
You've got a move. She's making an amendment. You need a second.
Is there a, does anyone want to second my change?
I will second that change.
Moved and seconded. Discussion on the amendment. Well, let's vote on the amendment first. It's been moved and seconded. All those in favor of the amendment, so signify by raising their hand. All those opposed to the amendment, 2-1. All those abstaining.
Could you have that vote again?
Yes, could we please vote again?
All those that are asleep. Shall we start that one over again?
Yes.
It didn't seem to go very well. Now, you out there, let's be quiet, because I got to watch this. All those in favor of the amendment, please raise their hand.
Where exactly is that being inserted? I didn't understand that.
You didn't understand the amendment?
No.
Read that again, will you, Phyllis, please?
Where it says, it is the intent of the Town Council to have all revenues generated within Fort Williams Park to be placed in the Fort Williams capital budget, excluding those generated by the Portland Headlight Museum. Just sort
that
of
clarifies and makes
clarification.
You've got a fund already for the, and you don't want to get that mixed up. It's
that's
very
right. We'll keep it separate.
Good word.
As it is with.
We've had that clarified now. All those in favor of the amendment, so signify by raising their hand. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Janet, you abstaining so far? Okay.
Yes,
5.
Sir.
All those opposed? You're still abstaining?
Yes, sir.
So I'll vote with the 5, and it's 6-0. Thank you very much. Now let's go back to the original order of business, and that is to get this draft motion with the amendment passed. May I have a motion on that, please?
You've got it.
All those in favor of the
excuse me
of the
excuse me
draft motion with the amendment, please raise a hand.
I think there's some discussion.
At the right.
You want
there's
some discussion on this? As some
yes, I'll be glad to discuss.
I don't want to discuss, but I'm sensing confusion.
Yeah.
I'm not as confused as I look. Be thankful.
You're confused, Richard?
I am not confused at all, but
we
I'm
want
sensing
to find
there might be some confusion.
No, I don't think so unless you bring it up. Counselor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm not going to vote in support of this. I know during our budget discussions, Counselor Jordan and I were both uneasy with this for various reasons, and I'm going to stick to my reasons, saying I retain my concern that if maintenance is not properly funded, then projects that are not maintained, items that are not maintained, become capital projects, and I don't like that possible scenario. That's why I abstained on what I think was a very good amendment, and I'm not going to vote in favor of it. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other discussion? Now we can get back to, I think, the draft motion as amended. We already have it. Motion made and seconded, so can we have a vote? All those in favor of the draft amendment, draft motion as amended, please raise a hand. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Those opposed? 5-2. It carries. Thank you. Counselor Jordan, item 164.
This is pertaining to the Fort Williams Park capital budget for fiscal year 1995. And be it ordered that the Gatesville Town Council, having held a public hearing on May 9, 1994, does hereby adopt the Fort Williams Park capital budget for fiscal year 1995 with gross expenditures and gross revenues of $34,800, including $10,000 as a transfer from the fiscal year 1995 general fund budget. I so move.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Discussion. All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. Before we move on to 165, everybody turn around and look at the wall where the booth is and see our new on-air sign. Isn't that great? You sit up here and it's just like being on Murphy Brown, on air.
Way to go, Mr. Chairman.
Item number 165, to consider a proposed reduction in the pending school project bond to reflect the ability to utilize savings from the date interest payments are made and take any necessary action. Manager McGuff.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The proposed budget contains a full 12 months of interest payment for the school bond based on an assumption of a 6% interest rate. We recently looked again at what an appropriate amortization schedule would be as to when the payments of principal and interest would occur during the fiscal year. We've changed them so that they are now proposed to be due right after the tax due date in April and October of each year. As a result of that, the very first interest payment has been moved forward almost 4 months. Therefore, the first payment we make will have almost fewer months in interest payments due than would otherwise be due. That amounts to approximately $200,000. We don't know the exact amount because we don't know the interest rate that we will be paying, although it looks like it'll be right on the 6% that we've been planning. What I'd like to propose is that we take the $200,000 in savings as a result of the interest rate payment speed up and apply that to a reduction in the amount of the bond to be borrowed from $11.7 million that was authorized by the voters last November down to $11.5 million. I did review this with the superintendent of schools, and she thought it was an appropriate way to look at this cost as well as to reduce by a large sum the amount that we paid over 20 years on the note.
Thank you. I have a motion on that.
I would move the manager's recommendation.
I'll second.
Moved and seconded. Discussion on item 165. Ready for the vote? All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. Item 166, to consider a proposed policy for the use of funds generated through the investment of proceeds from the school bond and take any necessary action. Manager McGovern, please.
Yes, thank you. During the time after we borrow the school bond until the project is complete, we will have some earnings as a result of cash flow. According to the statements that we have to show to the IRS in order to maintain the non-taxable nature of those bonds, we have to show that they technically roundabout going back into the project. We can address that by having the interest payments that we pay during the construction period, showing those as a project cost for the purposes of the IRS reporting. In the meantime, though, we do have some interest earnings on investment that if we don't meet all of the requirements that the IRS sets forth on us, we might have to rebate under the arbitrage rules to the federal government. Put simply, if one example, if you don't spend all the money in 24 months of the $11.5 million bond, we have to rebate any interest to the federal government, any interest earnings. What I'd like to propose is that we take those interest earnings and put them into an account, a reserve account for infrastructure improvements that would otherwise have to be paid for through the property tax. In essence, a reserve fund that will assist with not having to do projects that otherwise would be through the property tax. Some specific instances is we have a serious problem on the high school driveway with the ditch at the right side of the driveway. The driveway is starting to erode into the ditch, and it'd be an expensive project to take care of that ditch. The town center stormwater plan recommends it be filled. That's the type thing that this fund would be used for. But I would recommend that you you set aside the construction investment earnings into a reserve account in case a rebate is necessary, and then if not necessary, to be placed in a reserve account for infrastructure improvements that would otherwise have to be paid for through the property tax.
Thank you, Mayor. Can I have a motion on this?
Again, I would so move.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Discussion. All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. Number 167, to consider approving a bond resolution for $200,000 for previously planned Americans and Disabilities Act improvements at the Town Hall and at the Thomas Memorial Library and take any necessary action. Manager McGovern.
Thank you, sir. This particular issue was discussed at length by the Finance Committee a year ago. Specifically, the projects that it would entail is providing elevator access to the second floor of the Town Hall, replacing all of the existing handicap lifts at the library. Any of you that have used those have known that they haven't really worked right since the day they were put in, as well as locating and installing a fireproof walk-in safe for the tax office. Currently, we don't have that. That does not relate to ADA. It's a misnomer calling that an ADA project, but it does go under the heading with this project for the ADA bond.
Thank you. Can I have a motion on this recommendation? Councilor Coggeshall.
I move that we approve a bond resolution for $200,000 for the previously planned Americans with Disabilities Act improvements at the Town Hall and at the Thomas Memorial Library.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Discussion. Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. In looking at the information that was provided from the architectural firm that will be doing the assessment and valuation and design work for us, it appears that there will be about $25,000 fee to that firm. If you multiply the percentages by the anticipated $200,000. I spoke to the manager about that earlier today and asked where that money would come from, and his response was that would be part of the bond. So approximately $25,000 of fee to the architectural firm is included in the money to be bonded. And it may end up that we have to prioritize some of the recommendations so that we can cover them all financially through those monies. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilor Dahlbeck.
I'd like to amend Congresswoman Coggeshall's proposal to include the walk-in safe. I don't think that was mentioned.
I'll second that.
An accessible safe.
I just didn't want Michael doing editorial license without an amendment.
Wouldn't do that.
We have an amendment and we have a second. Any discussion on the amendment? Let's get that out of the way first, then, if we may. All those in favor of the amendment? 7-0. Now we have a draft motion with an amendment, and may I have a motion on that, please?
That's been moved.
I've moved that already.
Right.
I don't think I have. I argue that point every time. It hasn't been moved with the amendment. I couldn't because the amendment wasn't on there when you moved it.
Once you've moved the amendment, you've taken care of that.
I know, but you didn't read the same book I did. All those in favor of the
read any book.
Of the draft motion, so signify by raising the right hand.
I think there may be.
Oh, in the draft motion.
Do you want discussion?
Yeah.
We had discussion. Didn't you get a chance?
No, we just had one.
Sometimes it's more than the year.
This is going to be a long enough night without you. Discussion no, on the original draft motion.
As amended.
Right, yes.
As amended.
Mm-hmm. I just wanted to say that I think it's a good idea. I think we have a responsibility in a society to look out for people in wheelchairs. We wouldn't be much of a society if we didn't. And it helps people because it helps people help themselves. And you never know, one of us may be there someday. And I'm in favor for those reasons.
Thank you. Any other discussion? You ready for the question? All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. Number 168. To consider a request to request the Maine Department of Transportation to reduce the speed limit on Mitchell Road to 25 miles per hour and take any necessary action. Manager McGovern, please.
Yes, as the item indicates, a number of citizens have come forward recommending initially to the police department that the speed limit on Mitchell Road be reduced to 25 miles per hour. The process would be, if the council wished to pursue this, is that you would actually be making a recommendation to the Maine Department of Transportation. Speed limits are actually set by the commissioner of the department. There now are a number of residents here of the Mitchell Road area, and then the chief of police is here as well to respond to any questions the town council may have.
Thank you. Can we get this on the table with a, how would you like to do it? We got a request to request the Maine Department. If we get a draft motion and a second on the table, then we can have a discussion and we can let everybody into it. That's
Mr.
the way we should
Chairman,
go about it. Councilor Jordan.
Go ahead. I'll yield to the lady.
Councilor Coggan.
I was just going to suggest that we have the police chief present his reasons for his recommendation.
Miss. We'd like to do that, if you would, Chief.
I think you should have.
Chief, just if I may, I'd like to follow this up, if I may, with any residents that would like to speak right after the chief. You're going to be free to do so. Go ahead, Chief.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We have done quite a bit of work in the last month or so on Mitchell Road to determine whether or not reducing the speed limit from 30 to 25 would be justified. And in my opinion, as you see through my memo, I am recommending that it remain at 30 miles an hour. Several things that we have done in the last month leads me to that opinion, and the first thing is we do a number of speed checks along Mitchell Road, at least one a year, and in fact the last one we did at the request of the citizens down there involved about 511 vehicles. DOT hopes for a standard around 200 vehicles, so the check that we conducted there was about 2.5 times what DOT recommends to base their speed assumptions on. In that particular speed survey that we did, vehicle speeds averaged around 35 miles an hour, and that is what we consider to be in what's known as a window of non-compliance, acceptable non-compliance. Most people don't drive down a road going from speed limit to speed limit. People drive basically according to the ambience of the road or the character of the road, and we accept the fact that they will drive from 5 miles under the speed limit to 5 miles over the speed limit on average. The courts have accepted that too, because we have never been successful in prosecuting people for 5, 6, 7 miles over the posted speed limit. So we have to look at speed limits with an eye toward what we could successfully prosecute. And we felt that was an acceptable limit. Beyond the speed checks, we looked at the number of accidents we've had down there. We've had around 35 accidents in the last 5 years. Of those 35 accidents, Four have been speed-related, or at least had speed as a contributing factor. But just to put it into perspective, we called DOT to find out the latest figures in terms of vehicle travels up and down Mitchell Road. They had conducted a check in February of this year, which suggested that 2,600 vehicles per day use Mitchell Road. So over that five-year period, there have been 4,562,500 vehicle trips down Mitchell Road, four of which resulted in an accident with speed as a contributing factor. So volume was also of a concern to us because we felt that we're responsible for moving traffic, certainly moving it safely, but we have to do it in an efficient way. And finally, using DOT and other sources, we determined that critical rate factor, which some of you are familiar with, having worked on the streetlight issue or the traffic light issue, has been 0.79 and then reduced to 0.72 in 1993. So all of those factors combined does not suggest to me a necessity of reducing the speed limit to 25. I feel to do that, we're just going to have a great deal of noncompliance, and we're not going to improve the safety of that road at all. Before, you did consider to do that, however, if that was the pleasure of the council, go down Mitchell Road at 25 miles an hour, three or four times. It gets pretty stale, and I don't see anyone is going to do that routinely without just a great commitment of time on our part, from the police department's part, to see that that happens. So with that, I'll take any questions before I leave to the citizen comment.
Anybody have any questions for the chief? Councilor McLaughlin.
You can count on me.
You just made it.
I know. The four accidents that were attributable to excessive speed, were those in any particular location or were they spread out over the roadway?
Most of the accidents did tend to be on the Woodland Road end of Mitchell Road. In some of those instances, however, speed was a secondary contributing factor. The first contributing factor perhaps was road character or road conditions, icing, snow, something like that.
It's a bad corner at that end of it. So, thank you.
Anything else? Councilor Linnell.
Chief, in those accidents where speed was a factor, do we know what kind of speed they were going at? In other words, were they going 30 or 35 or 50? Or?
None were serious enough to warrant a full-scale reconstruction, so we wouldn't be able to predict exactly how fast. That's just from the officer's experience, skid marks, eyewitness accounts, or what other information we might have available to us.
Anything else for the chief? Thank you, chief. Residents of Mitchell Road, we're going to let you have a chance, too. Come on.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman and councilmen and women. My name is Marianne Lynch, and I live at 2 Leiden Lane, which is actually at the corner of Mitchell and Leiden. I live there with my husband, Greg Ginn, and three of our four boys, the fourth being off at school. I also would just note that I live, I guess, one block from where all the accidents attributable to speed are, so perhaps we're a little overly sensitive at that end, but it seems to be an area where people do tend to pick up the speed. We're here tonight, though, to ask this council to recommend to the Department of Transportation a reduction in the speed limit from 30 miles an hour to 25 on Mitchell Road. We think that this reduction in the speed limit would be more in keeping with the residential and suburban character of the neighborhood that Mitchell Road has become. We're here, and I want to emphasize, to discuss the speed limit and the appropriateness of 30 versus 25, not enforcement. I think that's a separate issue. No one that I spoke to at the Department of Transportation seems to know when this issue was last examined with respect to Mitchell Road. I spoke with Mr. Chase, the engineer. He was extremely helpful. I enjoyed speaking with him. He indicated to me that he may have been the person that set the speed limit last time, but that it was a significant number of years ago. It's my guess that when that speed limit was set at 30, Mitchell Road was more of a rural road. Earlier, it struck me as you gave the award to Peter and Alice Rand, someone talked about the turbulent 80s in terms of development, and Mitchell Road more than I think any other road in this town, has experienced that turbulent development. Alongside Mitchell Road, we have Hobstone, Cranbrook, Stonegate, Meadowview, Cheverus McCauley, Mantor, and Cape Woods. In addition, Mitchell Road itself has been filled in with almost every available building lot. And I personally think that that development that has occurred over the last 15 years is a significant factor that I hope this council will consider tonight when it looks at the issue. Another thing I hope that the council looks at is 29 MRSA Section 1252, which is the statutory speed law, and that provides that speed in excess of 25 miles an hour in a business or a residential district or a built-up portion, as defined in the law, is unlawful unless a different speed is fixed by the municipal officers and approved by the Department of Transportation. Again, I suggest to you that at the time that the speed limit was set, Mitchell Road may not have qualified as a residential district or within the built-up portion, but I think today that situation is different. I'd like to leave with you a copy of 1252 and ask you to please consider that in your deliberations as well. I think that this council ought to also consider the speed limit set on other roads in Cape Elizabeth. The chief had mentioned in his report Scott Dyer Road as the only road with a 25 mile an hour speed limit. And that's just not the case. Broad Cove Road has a 25 mile an hour speed limit, Oakhurst Road, Woodland, and Cottage Farms. All of those roads, but I think particularly Scott Dyer and Oakhurst, present similar characteristics and neighborhood conditions as Mitchell Road. And for the same reasons that this council must have had a role to play in setting the 25 mile an hour speed limit on those roads, I'd hope you would see your way to set a 25 mile an hour limit on Mitchell Road. I want to finish just by responding to Chief Pickering's observations that he had sent to you in a memo prior to the council meeting in opposing the reduction in speed limit. First, the chief has this observation that Mitchell is a collector road. Again, I just want to mention that times change, development occurs, and it looks to those of us who live on Mitchell Road more like a residential neighborhood than a collector road. Second, if it is a collector road, maybe our taxes all ought to be readjusted downward to reflect that fact. But I'm not asking you to do that. I'm instead asking you to recognize the residential character of the road. The chief also talked about an acceptable level of noncompliance. I don't accept that we should be teaching our children that there is an acceptable level of noncompliance. Frankly, of the 511 cars that were clocked in the last speed check, all but 64 were exceeding the speed limit. That's 85% by my calculation. The average speeds, based on information that I received from the police department, have increased over the last few years from 33 to almost 36 miles an hour. I think it was 35.8. So we're going in the wrong direction. Accident statistics the police talked about. Well, that's really a numbers game. I was involved in an accident on Mitchell Road this year, a block from Woodland. It was not my fault. I was hit by someone. That was an accident that the police did not list as speed, but clearly was, in my view and the view of a few witnesses, was speed that was in excess of where it should have been because of the road conditions on that stormy night. But I don't want to get too lost on the enforcement issue because I really don't think that's the issue. The issue that I want you to think about and that I hope you think about is what's an appropriate speed limit for a residential neighborhood. And we think 30 is just too high. The chief also talked about Scott Dyer Road as being first of all, being the only road, and I suggested to you that there were other roads with 25, but he also suggested that somehow Scott Dyer was different because Scott Dyer has a school and because it has pedestrians. Well, we're not potted plants on Mitchell Road. There's a lot of us who are pedestrians on Mitchell Road. There would probably even be a lot more of us that would be out there as pedestrians if the speed limit wasn't too high. And non-compliance, the chief's last point, I have a real hard time buying that one, too. I trust that if this council and the MDOT decide to reduce the speed limit, that the Cape Police Department will enforce any lawful speed limit set by the Department of Transportation. So I just don't buy that changing the speed limit in and of itself will result in, to use his terms, a dramatic increase in noncompliance. I trust that the police department won't let that happen. The police chief also offers that this shouldn't be changed because South Portland has part of Mitchell Road and that the speed limit is 30 in South Portland. That strikes me as the tail wagging the dog. Mitchell Road is a rather long road, but only 3/10 of a mile are in South Portland. And in between that 3/10 is a four-way stop sign. So no one at the South Portland end is getting up ahead of steam. And I think the chief's argument also suggests that neither town can do much about speed limits on roads that cut through both towns. And I just don't buy that argument. Whew. And I won't repeat everything I said to summarize it. I just hope that notwithstanding the chief's long list of reasons why you shouldn't vote to recommend to reduce the speed limit, that you will think about this one last point, which is that I don't see a downside to reducing the speed limit. And there's possibly a lot of upsides of having a road that people will feel good about riding their bikes and walking their children. And for those reasons, I'd ask you to think about lowering the speed limit. And I'd be happy to answer any questions. Thank you.
Thank you.
Let me leave 1252 with you.
Thank you.
Are there any other residents of Mitchell Road that would like this? Good.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman.
How are you tonight?
Very good.
Would you do me a favor? I didn't want to with the first one because I felt very strongly that we should hear the whole thing. Would you try to keep it down under 5 minutes for me?
Certainly. Thank you. Certainly. My name is Bill Hewitt. I reside at 243 Mitchell Road. Currently at that same address is a Ledgemere Country Day School. My wife is director of the nursery school, which has about 60 students of the age from 3 to 5 year old. I feel a very strong case should be made to lower the speed limit. It's only 5 miles, but it's a very important 5 miles. At the north end of my property, there is a big sign that says 25 miles per hour. Where the chief does his roadblocks, it's a 30 miles per hour. 100 yards up from that, it's 25. Those folks going 35 are currently 10 miles over the speed limit when they get to the end of my property. So I feel the enforcement is one issue, but we have now two parallels. We have a 30 and a 25 within 200 yards of each other. I feel if the whole road can't be 30, I feel there's a big heavy residence with the Oakhurst area coming into Mitchell and the South Portland and coming up to the Mitchell Oakhurst. There is numerous residents that, one, without a sidewalk, we have a difficult time walking on that road, difficult time riding bicycles, and therefore It's a dangerous situation. Currently own 300 feet on Mitchell Road and just became the third highest taxpayer on Mitchell Road with the latest revaluation. So I strongly feel that the voices here tonight and the people should be listened to, because there is concern. And we had one small tragedy with an animal that may have prompted this concern tonight. But I have a 1- and a 3-year-old, and I'd hate to have a tragedy in my family. Thank you.
Anyone else from Mitchell Road, please? Yes, sir. Name and your address, and away you go.
Mr. Chairman, Town Council, Town Manager, I'm Steve Etzel from 303 Mitchell Road. I'm glad I had a chance to get back here. I was halfway changing out of my suit when I saw this on television and decided to come back here. I just wanted to hear it a little earlier. I just want to address two different things. I am a resident of Mitchell Road, and I certainly support reducing the speed limit to 25 miles an hour. There were a couple reasons I really want to come back. Number one, what I felt was a very inappropriate use of statistics to state that there were several million, or I can't remember the number, millions of cars that had traveled in only 4 accidents. Statistics can be used to make almost anything sound phenomenal. We're not comparing apples to apples in this case. The real issue is the rate at which risk is increased by speed on a road where the travel way is only approximately 24 feet wide up to around 26 feet wide. The chief talked about the ambience, and then the characteristics of the road do control the traffic as much, and I think that's another reason to actually reduce the speed limit. There is a very close, what's called a road edge, visual road edge, when trees and plants are brought close to the side of the road, which tries to encourage people to slow down. The problem with Mitchell Road is its function. It gets used as a shortcut. A different way to make it longitudinally through the town of Cape Elizabeth, and there's nothing we can do about how that's laid out. We can do something about how fast people travel that road. The other issue I want to address was what I felt was an inappropriate remark by the chief of police to state that, sort of in a jokingly way, just try driving Mitchell Road at 35 miles an hour, I think. I'm sure he meant that in a joking way, but I don't think that's a very funny thing to do. Try driving Mitchell Road at 30 miles an hour and see what a nuisance you actually are. People come up on your bumper, people try to pass you, extremely inappropriate times, very unsafe. I like to drive Mitchell Road at 30 miles an hour, mainly to try to get people to not use it as a shortcut, to not drive 45, 50 miles an hour down the road. It's not a road created or evolved, especially with the number of people who park in the travel way and in its characteristics, to increase or to sustain a speed limit of 35 miles an hour. I just think if the 4 accidents, there happen to have been 4 accidents just in the 6 years I've lived near the S-turn in Mitchell Road. There have been 4 while I've been home. So I think there are a lot of accidents, and I know that 3 of those, because I was standing out in my yard when 3 of those cars went zipping by, certainly not at 35 miles an hour. I'm sure they didn't report that they were over the speed limit when they reported their accident. I think if 1, 2, 3, or 4 of those accidents that were caused by, as the police chief of police says, by speed, resulted in the death of a child or an adult, any human being, I think the mood of the board would be much different. I think there's a need to develop Mitchell Road into a residential street for the passage of the people who live in that area, and for that reason I recommend to the board, to the council, I'm sorry, that reduce the speed limit to 25 miles an hour. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Anyone else from the Mitchell Road area? Yes, sir.
Good evening. Thank you for this opportunity to speak to you. My name's Bill Alexander. I live at 403 Mitchell Road. I've lived there 20 years this summer. My introduction to Mitchell Road traffic was in August of 1973 when a yellow Volkswagen ran into a telephone pole in front of my driveway and tore off the electrical wires from my house that I had just had installed, plunging us into darkness. Since then, I've seen a number of accidents in front of my house. I've hauled cars off of the stone wall in front of my house. I saw a young woman upside down in a car in front of my house two summers ago, and I was very frightened by that for her. I have a son who's 12 and who's kind of wobbly learning to ride a 24-inch bicycle. I would be petrified if something happened to that child of mine. Yes, I think the chief is right. 25 miles an hour is dull. It's also safe. I think that's the best commentary of all that the chief offered. 25 miles an hour on Mitchell Road, you have to take the character of the road into consideration. You have to take the weather into consideration. No one knows more truthfully than I of the impact of the development on Mitchell Road. Bordered by my property and across the street, 160 housing units have been installed since the sewer was put in, 7 years after we moved there. There is no doubt that there is a lot of traffic, and probably the traffic does not vary in speed too much outside of the chief's analysis. But his comment to me a few years ago when I called one Saturday and complained about people going down the road too fast was that he felt what I was hearing was the volume of traffic and not the speed. I can tell the difference between a car going 30 and a car going 40. I drive 30 miles an hour to try to slow people down too, and they stack up behind me every day back and forth into South Portland. I urge you to lower the speed limit as well. I urge you to insist on enforcement. West Main Street in Yarmouth, where my in-laws live, is posted at 25 miles an hour. And the Yarmouth Police Department has taken great pleasure in enforcing that effectively. It has reduced the speed and it has reduced accidents along that stretch of road. My in-laws have been caught, and my father-in-law says he can't drive his car 25 miles an hour. It won't go that slow, but it will. And I urge you to ask the state to put in this lower speed limit, and as well that you urge the police chief to enforce this lower limit. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else from the? Yes.
Hello, I'm Mary Miller on Mitchell Road, and I want to thank you very much for allowing me to speak. When Mary Ann called, I said there's no way I'd want to speak to myself, but listening to what the chief had to say, I figured I needed to say something. I am not perfect. I too have a car that chooses not to go 25 miles an hour. But since Marianne's conversation, I thought, what better gift to give my children than the possibility that they wouldn't have to hear in the future that someone died because of speed. I've been there 8 years on 259 Mitchell. I have two children, one 2 and one 6. These children, if you're a jogger, I mean, they say it's not pedestrian. There are joggers all the time going by. There are bikers all the time going by. There are skaters going by all the time. Those people can hear cars and can choose to move out of the way. It's harder also when you have a carriage. I'd have to get to the other developments in order to be safe with the carriages with my children. I see many other mothers doing the exact same thing. As I said, I sometimes do go faster. Last summer, I know I was warned, and it makes you think, wait a minute, you need to go slower. This is not safe, and that there are more families around. The face of Mitchell Road has changed. I have been able to change. I was flagged down once by a parent going down Oakhurst Road, and that was the big thing for Oakhurst. I thought, oh, it's 25. Because I was flagged down, I looked at the speed, and since then I haven't gone past 25. I think others can learn the same thing because I know other people's speed. And as other people have said, the sounds increase. You know if somebody's speeding. It's not just the cars I'm concerned about. I was at Mary Ann's house the other day. I was walking out with my children, and it wasn't just the cars. It was truckloads loaded. And I know that they cannot stop when you have a full load of sand or gravel or it's tree stumps or it's a truck carrying a backhoe. It is not going to be able to stop or swerve for a child who's chasing a ball that's going to go out in the street. So I'd like you to take those under consideration. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Anyone else, please? We're going to find time for you, Mr. Walsh. Don't worry.
My name is Dirk Witham. I live at 209 Mitchell Road. I just want to say I have children 10 and 6, and I'm considered to be a rather mild-mannered person, but I have found myself over the 11 years that I've lived on Mitchell Road actually getting in my car and pursuing, maybe at six or seven instances anyway, people who were driving at an incredibly excessive speed, 40, 50, 60 miles an hour down that stretch. And I live at that stretch of woodlands that's considered very dangerous. I have, on a couple of occasions, actually caught those people. I talked quick, and they listened. But it's a concern. I have forbidden my kids to even go on Mitchell Road. I'm an avid jogger, and I can tell you that running up and down Mitchell Road, it is unbelievable the number of cars that just go by at excessive speeds. So I ask you, the council, to please listen to the voices that you hear, because we really are concerned very much. Thank you.
Mr. Walsh.
Thank you. My name is Greg Walsh. I had no idea this was on the agenda tonight, but I'm delighted that I happen to be here. I live on Belfield Road, about 100 yards from Mitchell Road, and I thank God very frequently that I don't live on Mitchell Road, but I live very close, and I'm one of the 2,000 boring drivers doing the stale drive into South Portland every day and back. And I'm constantly incensed by the people who tailgate, and I'm constantly incensed as a bicyclist by the situation with no sidewalks at all, and cars pass within a foot or two of bicyclists, usually at a very high rate of speed. We have children who ride up and down Mitchell Road constantly. They have no other way to get to their friends' houses, and there are no sidewalks. It's the kind of situation where you cross your fingers routinely. It's not a feeder road. It's a very residential road, and I think that the town could do a lot to keep it that way, and to remember that the chief's statistics were just that. They were just numbers, and there's a lot of people that live on that road, and sometimes courtesy, which is missing from a lot of our driving habits, can get a big boost from a little bit of legislation and a few signposts. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Yes, sir.
Thank you for letting me speak. My name is Jack Matheson, and my wife was the one that wrote the article in the paper. And I was the owner of that cat that lost its life due to an excessive speeding car. And I just wanted to say that I'm happy that we had a few people come out here tonight and talk to you folks. And I, as a father of a three-year-old, and I also an avid jogger, would like to use the road, and I also use, my daughter goes up to Ledgemere, and sometimes I feel afraid just to walk up there with her, because it's close enough to walk. I certainly don't want to drive, but if it's a matter of safety, if it's taking her in the car, then I'll do that, but I would rather walk. And to see these cars just continue to speed along at all parts times of the day, obviously the police can't be out there 24 hours a day, but you'd think people would maybe pay attention a little bit better if the speed limit was a little bit lower, and maybe comply a little bit better. That's about all I have to say.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone else? Thank you all for taking the time to come down and getting us acquainted with Mitchell Road, for those that hadn't traveled it too often. We certainly know what's over there now. What would the council, any questions of anybody that you heard tonight? What would you like to do with this item? I'll entertain a motion.
I'll move that we consider requests to request the Maine Department of Transportation to reduce the speed limit on Mitchell Road to 25 miles per hour and take any necessary action. I think that should be brought up as an item on the agenda. And then it can be voted on accordingly.
Your motion, Mr. Jordan, is to reduce the speed limit on Mitchell Road to 25 miles per hour, a request of sort?
My motion is to request the Maine Department of Transportation to reduce the speed limit. I'm not saying I agree with the speed limit at this time, but I think what they have asked for is the Department of Transportation, which has to review it first. Anyway, I believe if I'm mistaken, I would like to have the chief come down and explain it to me. I think the process is that the Department of Transportation has to review it and send a request back to the council.
I have a motion. If I got a second?
I'll second.
Moved and seconded. Discussion. Councilor McLaughlin.
I'm a bit uneasy in taking an action on this evening. My preference would be that we formally advertise this as a public hearing for the June meeting. I think there are people who may not have been aware that this was going to be discussed tonight and would like to have a voice in it, and I personally need some more time to think about it and get caught up with all the ramifications of that piece of legislation.
Thank you. Other discussion? Councilor Linnell.
I'd like a little more time to think about it, too. And I mean, people in this neighborhood have brought up some very serious concerns. I would like to say one thing in defense of the chief. I think his suggestion about trying to drive down there ourselves is a fair thing to say. I think it's a fair thing to do. If we would insist that people drive that speed, I think we ought to try it. And but I'd like to chew on it a little more, too.
Thank you. Councilor Coggeshall.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. If we're going to postpone making a decision on the 25-mile-an-hour speed limit, I would like to know from the manager what exactly is involved to get input from the Maine Department of Transportation, so that if we set this for a public hearing next week, we can make a final decision and not delay this another month or two.
Yeah, actually, the Maine Department of Transportation review is actually a separate action from the town's review. They have their own criteria that they look at. The municipality has its criteria. When, you know, Mr. Chase looks at this, he makes a recommendation to the commissioner. If necessary, the council could request another hearing with the hearing officer of MDOT to come to Cape Elizabeth. But to, you know, as the statute indicates that Ms. Lynch gave out, that, you know, really what you're talking about doing is reversing an action whereby many years ago the speed limit was set at 30 jointly by the council and by the commissioner. In order to reduce the speed limit, both of you would have to agree to vacate that 30 miles per hour speed limit, thus returning it to a 25 mile per hour speed limit. Well, any street that isn't posted in Cape Elizabeth is automatically 25, anyway, unless it's posted for a higher limit.
Councilor Dalbec?
Yes, I had two or three thoughts. Number one, I would want clarification on what happens when you request MDOT to do a review, whether you've already dug the hole or whether they come back with recommendations, because I know the final authority, I believe the final authority, does rest with MDOT.
Yeah, Mr. Chase of MDOT is here this evening, if you want to ask him specifically.
That might be a good idea to get educated. Lee?
Good Good evening. I'm Lee Chase, Division Traffic Engineer, Maine Department of Transportation, TV operator for Cape of Elizabeth, and I live at 1 Ocean House Road. So if you're looking for a clarification, you're correct. Once a speed limit has been established jointly by the town and the Department of Transportation, it then goes back through to the Department of Transportation. His ruling is made with the advice and consent of the Chief of the Maine State Police. Now, one thing I should clarify right off quick, that this law was written back in the 60s and 70s when they developed or formed the Maine Department of Transportation and eliminated the old Highway Commission. The reasoning at that point was a lot of these roads were out in rural areas, and this is why the state police is involved. Our departmental policy is that when we're in a built-up type town with a town government such as you have in Cape, a very viable police department, we consult very closely with that council and the police department as far as their input and their feeling on what a speed limit should be. Basically, if nothing had ever been done, there is a possibility the town might have got away with setting Mitchell Road at 25 miles an hour. It does not actually specifically meet the requirements of a speed compact 25, but it might be close enough that if we hadn't gotten involved with it, and I believe it was back in the 70s that I was here, because I've been doing this for a long time, I could very well have been the guilty party. I apologize for setting 30. At that time, I think there was a question on our mind that 30 might have been a little bit low. But anyway, it was set at 30. It was agreed to by the town and the Department of Transportation, and it went through that way, and it's been that way for several years. There is absolutely no problem with the town asking for a review. I mean, things change. Areas build up. Conditions change. Perfectly acceptable to have it reviewed again. And this can be done. We do ask for a request from the town. It is a town way. And as soon as we get that, we'll do it.
Your response comes back as an analysis, not as a mandate?
Unfortunately, no. Our analysis will come back from the commissioner as a mandate.
Thank you.
Councilor Coggeshall.
Yes. How long of time frame does it take for this to be reviewed and to get back to us?
Normally, you're looking at 5 or 6 weeks.
And we're really getting into the outdoor season where there are a lot of bikers and everything. Yeah. Perhaps we, as a council, if we choose not to make the recommendation or request tonight, would recommend that there be extra enforcement of that speed limit until we do get some sort of final decision. So if we've got a time frame, at least that would be something we could be doing while we're waiting for some other decision.
If I could make a suggestion, there are maybe one or two things that you could do is look at the worst areas of the road, the S-curves, make sure that there are warning signs. Also, I have looked at the road, living here in town, because I was curious, wondered what we're getting into. There are not an over excess amount of speed limit signs on that road. There is a possibility that after people turn on up here at the junction of 77 and Spurwing, it's a long haul, I think, through there before they see a speed limit. You might want to recommend to the Public Works Department to add some signs at some of the intersections, just as a reminder to people that it is 30. And I really feel that if people drove 30 through there, that it would make quite a difference.
Yeah, I think I would go along also with the idea previously mentioned that we have a public hearing so that all sides. I am concerned about this from a public standpoint, what it means to Shore Road, which I consider to be probably as residential in many respects as I do Mitchell. I am also very familiar with Yarmouth, having child and grandchildren out that way, and fighting the 25-mile speed limit through the center of Yarmouth. And I know that can be trying, particularly if it's over a long distance. I just think there are a lot of factors here that we need some answers to, and we ought to try and get those answers, but I'm a little against rushing to an overly fast conclusion, I guess.
Thank you. Any other questions? Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Councilor Jordan.
I don't think my motion was to act upon anything tonight. I think the way I read my motion was to request Department of Transportation to review the Mitchell Road as far as the speed limit. And I'm not 100% sure that 30 miles an hour is too fast. The trouble is 30 miles an hour, you can't do anything until they go 35 or better. So if it's 25 miles an hour, then they're going to be able to go 30, because they take, as I understand, they take them to court, they won't do anything unless you're better than 5 miles over. So I think it should be reviewed, and that was my intent of my motion.
We have a motion and a second that it be we request that it be reviewed by the Department of Transportation. Is that right, Councilor Jordan?
Yes.
And that was seconded.
Right.
So can we get that out of the way first, if there is anything else afterwards, or can we vote on that one?
Discussion.
Councilor Dahlbeck.
I think if I heard Mr. Chase correctly, if they review it and come up with a conclusion, that's basically mandated. Thank you.
Yeah. Councilor Coggeshall.
If this motion should pass, perhaps we should emphasize the study, concentrate not on on that particular area where all these new developments have gone in, the particular stretch of road from Cranbrook on towards South Portland particularly, because I have lived on the Oakhurst area, and even way back then, it was a tricky road to drive.
Other discussion? We have the motion and the second. All those in favor of the motion, so signify. Four, yes. All those opposed? Three, no. 4-3. Thank you. Item number 169, to consider a request from a citizen to purchase a portion of lot R2 13A and take any necessary action. Manager McGovern.
Getting quick. Thank you. I received a request back in early March from Dennis Flavin, who lives at 395 Ocean House Road, to purchase a portion of the town-owned lot next to his property. The specific location of this is along the what is popularly known as the Strip, out here beyond the town hall on Route 77. Mr. Flavin currently has one house on the property. He'd like to have sufficient square footage and frontage, etc., to be able to build a second home. The land just next to it on the other side of the lot, 15A, is a lot that is owned by the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. There are representatives of the Land Trust here this evening. I also solicited comments from department heads, from the Planning Board, and from the Conservation Commission. From the department heads, I received back one response that was more of a personal opinion than a professional one, so I won't bother to pass that one on. Beyond that, the Planning Board has recommended that the land be continue to be held by the town, and this an identical recommendation came forward from the Cape Elizabeth Conservation Commission.
Thank you, Mr. McGovern. May I have a motion on item 169?
To consider a report from the town manager regarding updating the...
Nope.
Excuse me, I skipped it. 169, to consider a request from the citizens to purchase a portion of lot 2A-13A, R2-13A, take any necessary action.
Is that a motion?
That's a motion.
Second.
Motion and second. A discussion? Councilor Coggeshall.
I was just going to ask Mr. Jordan if he was in favor or not in favor of the request.
I'm in favor of the request.
Do you want to? I didn't understand your motion, I guess.
Item 169.
Yes.
To consider a request from the citizen, for a citizen to purchase a portion of lot R2-13A and take any necessary action.
And your motion is that we approve the request?
That's right.
And that is seconded?
That is correct.
Discussion? Councilor McLaughlin.
Yeah. If there's public, I'd like
to... Yes, you'd rather have that first?
Yes.
Is there anybody here tonight that would like to speak to this item? Mr. Rand, come forward, please, and give your name and your address, and away you go.
D. Rand, 1222 Shore Road, and I thank you for the coffee and the crumpets. They were delicious. And you've seen a lot of me tonight, so I'll be very brief about this. Randy Blake, the chairman of the Cape Coast Land Trust, and I are here tonight to recommend to the town that they hang on to the land that they own for two reasons. First reason is that we came to you about 2 months ago to have you thankfully accept a conservation easement from the land trust to protect our property, which abuts the town property, which then abuts the land that the owner of which is asking to buy some land from the town. The conservation easement was put in place to an attempt to retain the character of what's left of the character of that part of Route 77, so that there would always be a forest there rather than houses to look at, and there would be some aspect of the rural part of the quality of the Cape preserved in that area. And so it would be, we would be therefore opposed to any anything that would increase the development along that road. The other reason, when we were before you to present the easement, I think it was Councilor Dalbeck that was concerned that what we were doing was in fact spot conservation. We didn't have the opportunity at that time. He was concerned that was this a part of the greenbelt. And so I did my map work, and what you have before you here is a map of a greenbelt. This is the town's greenbelt map. And to demonstrate that there is an arm of the greenbelt that, in fact, comes from Great Pond through the conservation easement that we have over at Great Pond Condominiums, it goes behind this development here and then through this land that the town owns to attach to the remainder of the greenbelt that goes down to Zeb's Cove. This arm of the greenbelt has been in place since we first conceded the greenbelt way back in about 1970-something or other. And our land is the Pools and the Richardson so nicely gave to us is here, and the town land is right here. And you can see that it does represent, the town land is the only access we have directly to get through there. And so we would be therefore opposed to anything that would impinge on that land. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Anybody else from the public here tonight that would like to speak on this issue? Thank you. Question, discussion from the council, please. Councilor McLaughlin.
I'll admit I was a bit confused when I was reviewing this item in the packet, and I did ask Mr. McGovern about it today. I want to make sure my understanding is correct and everybody else is also, that the Flavins, is that how you pronounce it?
I believe so.
Flavins own a lot that is potential, if they acquired a certain amount of property, a third of an acre from the town in our abutting lot, they could create a second lot. My initial concern was that they had a lot that they couldn't build on at all. They already have a developed lot. They're trying to create a second lot. My initial concern was, you know, what happened to these people's property rights, and I don't think anything has happened to their property rights. They're looking for additional property rights with the addition of town property to bring that about. I do agree with the recommendations that we've had from the Planning Board, the Conservation Commission, the Land Trust, and I get it from some department heads, not to sell any of this town property. I think that would be setting a very unwise precedent, and I'm not in favor of doing that. Thank you.
Any other discussion, please? Councillor Coggeshall.
I concur 102% with Councillor McGovern. That's because she said it first. But I also think that we have worked too long, different councillors and members of the different boards and commissions in town have worked too long to try to develop this concept, and it's really starting to progress, and I think selling off land that is part of that concept is a very bad precedent.
Thank you. Other discussion? We have a motion from Mr. Jordan. Was that seconded?
Yes.
It was? Thank you. We have a motion, and it's been seconded. And can we vote on that, please? All those in favor of the Jordan motion to approve the request from a citizen to purchase the portion of lot R213A, so signify, please. All those in favor? One. All those opposed? That doesn't carry. 6-1.
Six.
Do we need another motion on that, or will that take care of it for you, Mr. McGovern? That takes care of it. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Could you please note that it was 1-6?
1-6.
The way it was.
1-6.
It was 6 no's and 1 yes.
I understand.
Okay. You got that now? Okay. 170. Item 170. To consider a report from the town manager regarding updating the traffic regulations relating to parking and the movement of traffic in the Pond Cove school complex and take any necessary action. Manager McGovern, please.
Yes, thank you. The current traffic school parking regulations provide there's no parking on the certain areas of middle school mall and other areas that will no longer be in existence once the new project is under construction this summer. It's therefore necessary to revise the ordinance. I've come up with some draft language, which I'd recommend be referred to the school board and to the ordinance committee, so the school board can see as well what is being considered on.
Thank you.
Within the school.
Can I have a motion, please? Grounds.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we refer the proposed language to both the school board and to the council's ordinance committee. Do we want to set a time frame for this?
Yeah.
What would you recommend, Phyllis? August? Sure.
Are you having meetings in July?
If
sure.
We need
no,
to
we
build.
Need we need to because we'll be under construction.
I think so. Since and that we get a report back at the August council meeting.
Second that, please.
July.
You did?
I'll second it just so we can discuss it.
Moved and seconded. Discussion, please.
Did this originate with the building committee partially? I'm wondering if the ordinance committee really needs to consider this. It's pretty straightforward, and it has to do more with the town council setting parking regulations. If it meets with the approval of the school board, I would think that we had just approved it.
No, they didn't. I saw it was something needed to be done, and I did it.
It
really
looked like your language.
It was based on what I was hearing at the meetings.
Yeah.
And also the zoning board, where they put a stipulation on the approval that there couldn't be any parking along Scott Dyer Road on the sidewalk, and the current ordinance doesn't allow it, but this at least clarifies that during the construction period there may be some parking authorized along there.
And the chief has reviewed this, so you feel it covers all the issues.
Okay. Other discussion, please. Councillor McLaughlin.
I quite frankly would like to see it go to ordinance committee. I have some concerns with some of the proposed language. On page 2, it's talking about you can park only where parking is permitted. People, I find, respond sometimes better to no parking signs, NO parking, rather than parking permitted here. I'm probably one of the counselors who is up at that school complex as much, if not more, than anybody else. And I saw today when I went in from Scott Dyer down by the mall, there were signs that I think were new. I don't always notice the signs. I noticed the stop signs, but not all the parking signs. And I think some of those were new, but I just thought the wording is just a little different, and I'm not sure people are going to understand where the permitted areas are. I also want to make note that there's a recommendation that there'd be no grassed area. There are a fair number of people who currently are parking on grassed areas. And one of the reasons for that is for their accessibility to the playing field. I want to make sure that there's parking for people who want to go to the playing fields. And I would hope the ordinance committee can consider that if they do a review of this language. I'm not sure, maybe that's not in their purview, but somebody's going to make sure that there are places for people to park who go there for the various uses on the school grounds, be it during construction, be it in the summer, or be it next fall.
We have two new parking lots in the school plan, a 200-space parking lot that overlooks the two newer fields. There's also a proposed community parking lot that's right down below the field hockey field that has about 60 spots. If any kid ever got hurt with the current situation with vehicles parking on grass, the town wouldn't have a leg to stand on. You know, just because it's... You know,
I'm not saying we should park in the grass.
No, it's, I just want to make absolutely clear that the current rules don't allow that. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we have gotten after them at different times, and it's a situation that has just gotten out of hand. And I don't want anything said tonight to encourage anyone to think that they can now do it.
No, I certainly didn't mean to give that impression. And there are more than kids parking on the grass. There are plenty of adults parking on the grass. And I've been guilty of it myself, but I didn't do it today because I knew this was coming up tonight. But I just want to make sure that, you know, during construction season, those fields are still used. And next fall, those fields are going to be used. And I want to make sure, you know, those parking lots, I don't think, are going to be ready at that time. So I want to make sure that we do have adequate parking still, and people know where it is.
Councilor Dahlbeck.
All right. Well, number one, all the fields will not be used along Scott Dyer, if I understand the staging of some of the construction. So, you know, for a couple of years, we're going to have to be doing a lot of bending. It's not going to be business as usual and what else, so we'll never get a school there. Number one comment. Number two, I think I really agree with Councilor Coggeshall on this, that if the police department and the school department, because a lot of this is on school-controlled property, but if those two agree, I think we get overkill in them and delay going to the ordinance committee, and I just wonder if that's really necessary.
Thank you. Other discussion?
That's right.
Councilor Jordan.
Yes, I just want to say is that until we provide parking area up there, and I've been up there a few times lately as far as the cross area there, and practically everybody parks on the grass that can get down in there anywhere near the field. So I think if this isn't enacted right now, that it's got to be overlooked a little bit until we provide some spaces, because I myself has drove down in there and parked on the grass. I don't see there's any harm there around where the woods are there and the bushes and what have you. Do you come up against the fence? So I don't know. I don't think it's really necessary to go to the ordinance committee, but to getting through the process, it's going to be a year or two here now. It's going to be a tight area for parking.
Thank you. Councilor Nell.
I think it would be appropriate to give the fire chief and the police chief and the school board some flexibility here to do what they want to get this project underway.
Thank you. We have a motion, I believe, on the table to approve the recommendation of the manager. And I believe that was seconded, and we have been having a discussion on it. So if you want to change that, we got to get rid of that motion first. So we, on the motion that we refer this to the school board and to the ordinance committee, all those in favor, so signify. We have one yes and six no's. All those opposed, so signify. We have six no's and one yes. So we're, now, we're open for new motions. Counselor Dahlbeck.
I'll try it. I would move that we approve the draft provided us as item number 170 by the town manager, conditioned on approval of the public safety departments, the two public safety departments and the school board.
Thank you. Is there a second on that?
Second.
Moved and seconded. Discussion. Counselor Coggeshall.
Do we need to set this for public hearing, Michael?
Yeah, it's an amendment to the ordinance, and you would need to hold a formal public hearing.
Should we be setting that date now?
Would you?
It's up to the council if you want to do that, or you want to wait to see what the school board suggests.
I think we've got to wait till they meet and give us some...
I'm just concerned about constructionists hopefully starting this summer, and we're going to be still ditzing around with this at Christmas time the way we're going.
This should be in place by September 1st.
At that rate, we ought to have... Can't we schedule a public hearing at the next meeting?
For the August meeting.
August meeting?
July.
July meeting. Would you put that in your...
I would amend my motion to include...
Will the second still go along with that? All right. Been moved and seconded that we refer this to the appropriate safety departments and the school board, and they have a public hearing on it in our August meeting, July meeting with council. Discussion.
We need a date, specific date.
We do.
July meeting. Oh, yes.
July
11th.
July 11th.
July 11th.
At 7:30.
Thank you. You have the...
Town hall.
That's right.
I'll talk with this side here. You're much friendlier over here.
Oh, that's us.
Any discussion of the motion? All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. Number 171, to consider a report from the Planning Board regarding dead-end roads and take any necessary action. Manager McGovern.
This one, I worded it carefully. Unless the Ordinance Committee wishes to review this proposal again, I would recommend you set it for public hearing on Monday, June 13th.
So moved.
Moved and seconded. Discussion. All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you.
That's at 7:30 at the town hall.
To consider a report from the town manager regarding the impending closure of the brush and demolition area of the refuse disposal area and take any necessary action. Manager McGovern.
Yes, this is probably the most controversial issue the town council will handle during this calendar year. We're under federal and state mandate to close the entire brush and demolition area of the refuse disposal area, with the exception of the transfer station. The big pile where everyone takes the demolition material, the composting area where everyone takes the grass and leaves, where folks take their stumps and where also they take their brush, all of that has to be closed, and we need to find another permanent disposal site. This proposal recommends that we adopt new policies which encourage reuse, recycling, and volume reduction, that we go to some fees, and that the fees be similar to those found in neighboring communities, that whatever we do is environmentally sound, that we meet the mandates, and that we keep as much as possible a low impact or little impact on the property tax. We have worked out an arrangement whereby Portland would be willing to accept material from us. However, it is at the Riverside Hamlin's Pit, which is 9.5 miles from this building. That is a considerable distance. The proposal here does provide that we would still take some materials at the refuse disposal site. We'd put them in roll-off containers and haul them there, where we would then be responsible for the fees. In Portland. It does propose that, with the exception of landscaping for grass and brush, that we would not accept material from contractors. Anyone building a new house would have to have a dumpster on site. Anyone with doing a renovation over so much square foot would have to have a dumpster on site. Anyone that builds a new subdivision would have to chip all of the brush on site and reuse it back into landscaping on site rather than hauling it all the way across town. There's discussion here of incentives for backyard composting. Essentially, it's turning upside down what we're now doing there. I do think that the mandate was due to be met a year ago, December. I worked on a committee with Sherry Huber and the head of the Maine Waste Management Agency, with former Commissioner Marriott, with other DEP staff members and municipal officials, where we did get some changes to the law. However, it doesn't really help us because we're adjacent to an old solid waste landfill. And under the federal rules, the state can't provide extensions of deadlines, nor be very lenient in areas that are adjacent to solid waste landfills. And because we're adjacent to a solid waste landfill, we can't compost over that old landfill, over that big flat area. We're not going to be able to use that at all, other than for recreational type use. It cannot be used for staging. I went up there with Bill Jordan one day and met with the DEP staff person, and I think we were told even the newspaper bin and some of those places would have to be moved. And while I think the DEP might be more lenient than that, nonetheless, we are looking at a totally new operation there. And this is an issue that I think ought to be referred perhaps to a full council workshop, because it is so significant, and that you meet on that with the Director of Public Works as soon as possible and invite the Recycling Committee in as well, since this does have impacts on recycling.
Thank you. May I have a motion?
I would move that we refer this to a council workshop.
I'll second.
Moved and seconded that we refer this to a council workshop. Discussion, please. Councilor Coggeshall.
Unfortunately, I misplaced the date for the composting demonstration that's going to be given by the Recycling Committee. Does anyone know what that date is so we can announce it?
I was in the Cape Courier.
It's in the Courier.
I know.
Read the
latest issue of the Courier. I'm afraid I misplaced mine somewhere.
At the table, Deb.
Yeah. You recycled it.
I recycled it, yes.
Already.
Deb's going to get a Cape Courier.
You recycled that whole paper so quick with all that good information?
Well, I had read it, so.
If anyone would like a copy of this report, I'll make some available, and we'll have them in the office, and we'll try to get it distributed, particularly to contractors, some of those most affected, so people can start giving it some consideration.
Has a copy of this gone to the Recycling Committee?
No, it's proposed that you refer it to them, so upon your referral, it will go to them.
Well, if they're coming, the motion I'm hearing is that we have a workshop and invite them, so I think they should have a copy of it before they come to the workshop.
Yeah,
definitely.
That would be nice, yeah.
Thank you. I'm still awake.
Yeah. Known as the dump from 8:30 a.m. to 2:30 p.m. Saturday, May 21st. That help?
Yes, thank you.
If needed, thank you. Any other discussion?
Yeah, I just want to reemphasize, this is going to be difficult, it's not going to be popular, but the reality is that we need to close that site. And how we do that, and what we set up for fees, what we set up for what we take and what we don't, it's going to be a real balance between what goes onto the property tax and what the individual user ends up paying. And that and who does the hauling, the individual user or the town. And you're going to have to weigh each of those as you eventually come up with the policy.
Thank you. We'll set that workshop up a little later. Any other discussion on that motion? All those in favor of the motion, signify. 7-0. Thank you. Item 173, to consider a report from the Cable Television Advisory Committee regarding the certification of the town to regulate basic cable service rates and take any necessary action. Manager McGovern, please.
This is an issue that under the FCC, the Cable Communications Act of 1995, 2002, I think it was, we were given authority to regulate cable rates. Town didn't do anything for a while on it. Finally, Public Cable sent us a letter saying, and actually a form saying, please regulate us. Well, I was suspicious immediately. Nonetheless, did speak with a number of municipal officials in other areas, spoke with the cable company. The cable committee met with Jeff Darrell of the cable company, and they did vote, I believe it was unanimous, to recommend that we do seek to obtain certification. I do want to indicate to you that it was not a strongly held view. It was, yeah, it's, you know, they went back and forth and felt that, you know, for the most part, there'd be less harm in being certified because it still didn't obligate you to get into a rate-making procedure. You know, obviously, we were concerned with the Portland Water District rate case and how involved that was and what that cost. And, you know, in this instance, it would probably be some of the larger communities, if there was ever a dispute, would take the lead on it. And, you know, we would be there as well to ensure that whatever rate benefit other communities got was also extended to Cape Elizabeth residents. And that's the threat Public Cable's held out, that, you know, perhaps that, you know, if other community regulates, that they'll get a lower rate than Cape Elizabeth, and certainly you don't want to see that happen. That's is what they've stated. So, you know, whether or not, in fact, that would happen, I don't know. It's a close call.
Thank you. May I have a motion, please? Councilor Coggeshall?
I move that we, as a council, have a discussion and really know what this entails. We have a page here of very technical language from the federal government, and now you're saying that we have to go through the certification process, and we don't really know what that involves and if it really is of any benefit to us. So I'd just like to have us discuss this with the cable committee or with the public cable company. So I move that we have this also as a workshop item.
Also as a workshop item. Is there a second on that?
Second motion.
Moved and seconded. Discussion? All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. Item 174, to consider a report from the Appointments Committee regarding a vacancy on the Board of Trustees of the Thomas Memorial Library and take any necessary action. Councilor McLaughlin, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We had an unexpected vacancy on the Board of the Library Trustees of the Thomas Memorial Library, and the Appointments Committee unanimously is recommending the appointment of Patricia Twitchell to that board. She's currently serving on the Recycling Committee. However, the Library Trustees is definitely her first choice. I've spoken with her about this, and she'd be delighted to make the switch. We understand that makes a opening now in Recycling Committee, and we're planning to try to get that and our other committees up to full speed. Thank you. And so I would move that we approve the appointment of Patricia Twitchell to Library Trustees for a term to expire January 1, 1996.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you.
Thank you.
Item number 175, to consider a proposed purchase of property located at 316 Ocean House Road and take any necessary action.
Mr. Chairman,
Councilor Coggeshall.
As in with past discussion on this item, I ask that I be excused because of a perceived conflict.
You're excused.
Thank you.
And who would like to start this off? Manager McGovern.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. For some time, the town has been looking at the space needs of our public safety department, specifically the fire department, including the rescue and the wet team, as well as the police department and the public safety dispatchers. It was extensively looked at in the years 1989 and 1990 by the Cape Elizabeth Municipal Facilities Committee. That particular committee did recommend that we find new space for our public safety departments. Specifically, they looked at the possibility of expanding at the current site and felt that that might in fact be feasible. However, in looking at it, what they ended up doing was taking the whole parking lot in back of the current public safety building and also expanding a building right out so that it took up a little bit more than half of Jordan Way. As an alternate, they also looked at expanding on the other side of the building, which violated the setback tremendously with the property on this side of the public safety building. In addition, we've looked at a number of areas over the years for public possible siting of a public safety facility. For an earlier agenda item, you had the Flavin lot. We looked at purchasing that lot before Mr. Flavin bought it to see if that held any potential for a public safety building. This was back around 1989-1990. The council, over the last few months, it's fairly clear at this point, has probably had some discussions about this. We've gone into executive session a few times. While I can't say what the discussions are, I have been, as a result of that, speaking with the representatives of the lot next door, Pond Cove Associates, about a possible purchase of that lot. We have been going back and forth for, I would say, about 6 months at this point, with the town taking an extensive look at a possible value of it, but even more so at the soils on the property, at the property sizing, as well as looking at other alternatives we might have for future public safety expansion. I did offer to them a proposed purchase and sale agreement. However, that was conditioned upon two conditions. One was that anything I did in signing a purchase and sales agreement was subject to a public vote of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council this evening. The second condition that was in the purchase and sale agreement was that the tenant agree to a lease. It wasn't the town's immediate interest to have that particular property used for a public safety purpose. It's very well known that we're going through a revaluation, that folks are concerned about that and the impact of taxation, the school project, and you know, concerned with the overall town indebtedness and overall town budgets. This simply isn't the time to continue on with a lot more projects. The sense is, you know, we need to be cautious, but yet at the same time, we ought not to miss an opportunity should one arise. The opportunities don't come up too often for a site that could potentially be used for one of the public safety departments. Specifically, there are a lot of limits as to where you can put one of these things. No one wants to have a fire station right next to them or a police station right next to them. They work 24 hours a day. They come and they go with lights and sirens and vehicles. And, you know, they're not, it really needs to go in a business zone. It really needs to be not at exactly a crossroads, but just off a